Hello friends, once again welcome to Diksha Classroom. This is the 16th day of Diksha Mission JRF. Okay, in the past 15 days we were discussing different questions from different topics of NTA NET Paper 1 syllabus. At the same time we have also discussed regarding different topics, also different question papers. So when we discuss with our friends regarding the feedback of our sessions, we are very happy to know that it's being felt as very useful for many of you. So some of our friends has told us regarding the tough topics like mathematical reasoning and data interpretation, so as to concentrate on the questions from these topics. So definitely we'll be dealing with all the topics, all the possible topics from the whole paper 1 syllabus, and we'll be also discussing some topics from mathematical reasoning as well as data interpretation. So that's the reason why we decided to discuss the next few sets by discussing data interpretation questions from previous exams. So we'll be giving you a task, one or two data interpretation questions will be given you as a task one. You want to do those questions for the next day, and the next day we'll be discussing those questions with the answers and explanation. I hope after seeing the video you will be clear with those data interpretation questions. Okay, so yesterday as Diksha task number 15, we have given you a set of two data interpretation questions. In this video we'll be discussing those data interpretation questions. So this will be the pattern we'll be following in the coming few days. Okay, so as to make sure that you are okay bit with data interpretation. Remember, data interpretation is a topic being felt by many students as one of the most tough topics out of the 10 topics along with the mathematical reasoning. The major reason why I feel that the students usually felt it hard is due to the presence of a large number of mathematical calculations. Okay, so in certain data interpretation questions, you can see more than 5 or 10 percentage type question. You have to calculate percentage more than 5, 10 or 15 times so as to get all the 5 questions from that particular table. Okay, but the importance of data interpretation is that if you are thorough with the table, if you are thorough with the mathematical calculation, and if you have the idea how to solve a data interpretation question, it's almost sure that you can fetch 5 questions. Remember, 5 questions means 5 into 2, 10 marks, which means 3.33%. Most probably, you would have missed the NET last time or JRF last time if you are a serious aspirant by a percentage less than 3.33. So remember, data interpretation can play a key role, a very important role in your JRF preparation, in your qualifying for the JRF. So remember I will tell you how you can crack that data interpretation, or what are the different things you have to be careful regarding while preparing for data interpretation. First thing is, make sure you are okay with mathematical calculations, especially calculation related to percentage, average, and then basic operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, etc. I'm sure all of you will be knowing those all things, but the important thing is that you want it should be possible for you to do all those operations within a very limited time. Okay, in mathematical reasoning, if you know the concept, there will be one or two mathematical tabulations so as to find the answer to a particular question. But in data interpretation question, you may have to do more than 3, 4, or 5, in some cases more than 10 mathematical tabulations so as to get all the set of questions. So first of all, so as to crack data interpretation question, you should be thorough with mathematical calculations. You should be possible to do mathematical calculation in a limited period of time. How to have such a capability? There is no shortcut. You have to do maximum number of questions. So that's a second aspect, second strategy to crack data interpretation question. That's to go through maximum possible number of data interpretation questions from previous exams. It's very important, because the issue with data interpretation question is that you don't have hundreds or thousands of types. There are only a few types. And what they do is that usually NTA put the data interpretation question in such a way that almost same type of pattern will be repeated if you are going through the past question papers. They will be changing the values, they will be changing the names, but the basic concept will remain same. So one of the most or one of the easiest method to crack data interpretation questions is to go through all possible previous questions, so that you will definitely get similar pattern of question in the exam also. When we compare all the 10 sets of 2019 December paper 1 examination, we can see that almost all of the data interpretation questions were in somewhat similar to data interpretation question asked previous years, not the just 2018 exam, but if you are going through one more than 10 or 15 years question papers of data interpretation. So hopefully we'll be discussing different data interpretation questions in the coming videos, in the coming days of Diksha Mission JRF. In the next 4 or 5 days, we'll be discussing almost 10 of data interpretation questions. And the question paper will be given you as a task on the previous day. So the task for or the questions that we are discussing today have been already given you yesterday. If you are yet to receive those, you can download it from the YouTube description. The question will be also shown in the screen also. There is no need of pausing the video or going back to the description and to download for the time being. For the time being, you can see the video. You can try to do the questions, and after that you can download the question paper. Since if you are and also you from the description, you can also get the question paper for the tomorrow's task, for the tomorrow's video. And if you want to receive these question papers directly in your WhatsApp, you can join Diksha paper 1 free WhatsApp broadcast by sending join to 9847478690. Once again, 9847478690 via WhatsApp. The phone number and format is also available in the YouTube description. So if you are a part of Diksha WhatsApp paper 1 broadcast, we'll be sending you daily tasks in respective day through the WhatsApp. So you will receive that daily task through WhatsApp. So that's all about the introduction to data interpretation. Don't forget regarding the task number 16, that is task for tomorrow description, and the link is available in the YouTube description. So friends, let's go to the discussion of the questions of Diksha task number 15.
The following table shows the percentage of marks obtained by 5 students year 2E in 6 subjects S1 to S6 out of 80, 75, 100, 120, 125 and 150 respectively. In accordance with the table given below, answer the questions that follow. So first of all, the things you should understand is that there are 5 students A, B, C, D, E, and there are 6 subjects. And the most important aspect is that different subjects have different total marks. For example, S1 the total mark is 80, but S2 the total mark is 75, S3 is 100. So different subjects have different total marks. Also, they have given the percentage of marks. That means this 80, 70 to 76 is the percentage of marks, not the exact marks. You will be clear with those when we will be discussing questions one by one. So moving on to first question. This is the first question. The approximate average percentage of marks obtained by student A comes out to be. We know that in the question they have given us percentage, and here the question is also approximate average percentage of student A. So we have student A have 80 marks in S1, then 72 in S2 and 76 in S3, 80 in S4, and that way. So we want to find the average. So what we want to do is we will be adding the different marks of student A in S1 to S6 subject, that is 80, 72, 76, 80, 50, 65. We are not converting from percentage to marks. The reason is in the question they have asked approximate average percentage, not approximate average marks. Okay, so when adding the individual marks of A, we get it as 423. Okay, we get the marks as 423. The question is average percentage of mark. You will be knowing average is equal to value, that means the total value by number. Here the total value is 423. Total number of subjects is 6. So 423 by 6, which gives you 70.5%. 70.5%. So the question is the approximate average. So the answer will be D, 70%. Next, we are moving to the second question. This is the second question. The difference in the total marks obtained by students A in the subject S3 and S4 taken together and student E in the subject S3 and S4 taken together. That means student A, you want to take S3 and S4. Student E, S3 and S4. The important thing is that here they have asked total marks, not percentage. So first of all, we want to change this percentage into marks. We will be changing only those marks which are required. So student here, we need subject S3 and S4. Student here, subject S3 and S4. And student E, we need similar S3 and S4. In both of the cases, they have given the percentage. We want to change it into the marks. In S3, there is no need of specific changing because it's out of 100. So percentage and mark will be same. So this will be 76 and this will be 68. Since the mark is out of 100, percentage and mark will be same. And with regards to S4, we want to find out 80% of 120. 80% of 120 to find out, we'll be using the equation 120 by 100 into 80. 120 by 100 into 80, you will get it as 96. So 80% of 120 will be 96, and 60% is similar where 120 by 100 into 60, which fetch you 72. So 72. Now we are going to the question. What is the difference in the total marks obtained by student A in S3 and S4 and student E in S3 and S4? So we'll be adding those marks. They have asked the difference in marks, that is student A mark minus student E mark. Student A, we know 76 plus 96. Student E, we have minus 68 plus 72, which gives 172 minus 140. So that 140, so the answer will be 32. So first of all, we have found the value of the marks from the percentage. We have added the asked marks and we subtracted. So 172 minus 140, that is equal to 32. So the answer is option D, 32%. Okay. Option D, 32% is the correct answer. So this is the question number 2. Now we are going to the third question. The average percentage of marks obtained by all the 5 students together in the subject is 6. Again here, they have asked the average percentage, so there is no need to convert into marks. There is need to convert into marks only if there is, only if the question has been asked in marks. So in S6 subject, so we want to add all the marks of the S6 subject and we want to find the average. This is a marks of S6 subject and we want to find the average. So it will be 65 plus 72 plus 82 plus 70. that gives you 355. So we'll be using the same equation, average equal to total value by number. So here total value is 355. So to find average, 355 by 5, that gives you 71%. So the answer is 71%. Again, the question number 3 is similar as that of question number 1. In both cases, they have asked the average percentage. So we will be directly adding and directly finding the average. There is no need to change to marks. Then moving to question number 4. Here the question is, the average of marks obtained by all the 5 students together in the subject year. So again, here they have asked the average marks, not average percentage of marks. So we want to change this percentage into mark. And they have asked regarding the subject S1. So we'll be finding marks of different students in subject S1. So this is subject S1. So 80%, we'll be finding 80% of 80. You get it as 80 by 100 into 80. So 64. Next, 60% of 80 marks. Similar way, you will get it as 48. Then 45%, you get it as 36. 50%, just take the half, 40. 65%, 52. Remember, the difference is this is percentage, 80%, this is a mark, 64. Okay, the first value is percentage and the second one is marks. The question is average of marks. So next we want to add all these marks, that is 64 plus 48 plus 36 plus 40 plus 52. You get it as 240. 240 is the total mark of S1 subject of all students. So finding the average, we have to divide it by the total student, that is 5. 240 by 5 gives you 48. So the answer is 48%. 48% is answer. Again, listen the question, the average of marks. So just find the marks, add the marks and find the average. So the answer is 48. Next, we are moving to the last sub question of the first question. The difference in the marks obtained by all the 5 students together in the subject S3. Again, listen, difference in the marks obtained by all 5 students together in S3 and S1. S3 and S1. So difference in marks. So we want to find the whole marks of students in S1 and students in S3, and we want to find the difference. So we'll be finding in S1, we have already previously found that 80% is 64, 60 is 48, 45% is 36, 50% in 40, 52. So total mark of S1 is, we have already found it as 240. Total marks of S1 is 240. Now we want to find the total marks of S3. S3, since the question is out of 100, no need to find percentage, just take the value. So we want to add this one, 76 plus 88 plus 44 plus 72 plus 68. That will give you 348. 348. So the question is difference between the marks of S3 and S1. So 348 minus 240. That gives you 108. So the answer will be 108, option C. Again, here the question is difference in the marks of the all 5 students in S3 and S1. we just changed the percentage into marks, added the all marks, then we find the sum 348, the sum of the marks of S3, and 240, the sum of the marks of S1. We just find the difference, so the answer is 108. Okay, this is all about the question number one. Next, we are going to question number two of data interpretation. So this is a question. Consider the following two tables, 1 and 2. Table 1 shows the percentage of students who joined and successfully completed the PhD program from the universities A to G. And Table 2 shows the number of foreign PhD students enrolled in the university C. These percentages have been rounded to the nearest whole number. There are a total of 855 PhD students in the university C and total of 5700 students successfully completed PhD from all the 7 universities together. Based on this, answer the following questions. So here the thing you want to understand is that there are 7 universities, there are percentage of students who joined PhD, and also there are percentage of students who successfully completed PhD, and they have given 2 values. One value is the total number of students completed PhD, that is 5700. And another value is number of PhD students in University C, that is 855. And they have also given the foreign PhD students in University C, American 65, Australian 46. So before going to the question, let's find the value of students in each university. Value of students who joined PhD, as well as the value of students who successfully completed PhD, so that it will be easier for us to find the answers. So the first value we have is that the number of students who join for PhD in University C is 855. It's given. That means 10% is 855. 10% is 855. Based on this, you want to find what are 22%, what are 15%, 17%, 18, 12, and 16. It's easy to find, because given 10% is 855, which means 1% is 85.5. That means 1% means 85.5 students. There is no need to get confused by seeing the decimal number of students, because in the question it has been told that all the numbers have been approximated to the nearest whole number. So 1% is 85.5. So to find what is 22%, just multiply 22 with 85.5. To find 15%, multiply 15 with 85.5. 10% into 85.5, you get already given 855. 17 into 85.5, you get 17%. So from the given 10% equal to 855, we have found that 1% is 85.5, and we'll be finding all the rest percentage. 22% will be 22 into 85.5, that will be 1881. 15 into 85.5 is 1282. 17 into 85.5 is 1453. 8% is 684. 12% is 1026. 16% 16 into 85.5 1368. So now we got the number of students, the absolute number of students. Given is the percentage, we have here, we have find the absolute number of students who joined the PhD in 7 different universities. Next, we will be finding percentage of students who successfully completed. Here it's given that the total percentage is 5700, so we'll be finding 18% of 5700 and 17% of 5700. We will be using the equation, that is 5700 by 100, you get 1% into 18, you get 18%. So 18% is 1026. Similarly, 17% 5700 by 100, that gives you 1% is 57. So 18% is 18 into 57, 1026. 17% is 17 into 57, okay, and 16, and 13% 741, 16% 16 into 57, and 12. And so you will get in the middle box, you get the total number of students who join PhD in 7 universities, and in the right side you get the total number of students who completed PhD in from the different universities. So you have find out the values of the number of students who joined PhD and the number of students who completed PhD. Now we will be moving to individual questions. So this is the first question. What percentage of university is that of foreign students? We have the number of students in university C is 855, and the number of foreign students in university C is number of foreign students. We want to add all these students, you get it as 65 plus 46 plus 25 plus 35, you get it as 171. The question is, what is the percentage? That means we want to find 177 as how much percentage of 855, because the total number of students is 855. So the equation is 171 by 855 into 100. You get the answer as 20%. So question number one, what's the percentage of students in university C that is a foreign? We have added the individual foreign students, we get it 171. We know the total number of students in university C is 855. We find out what is 171 is what percentage of 855. So the answer is 20%. You get the answer as 20%. For the question number one. Next we have question number two. We have using the same table. In case there are 21 African students in university E, what is the percentage? So universities E, they are telling 21 students. University E, we have got it as total as 684. So just found 21 is what percentage of 684? 21 into 684. 21 by 684 into 100. You will get the answer as 3%. Okay, easy one. They have given 21 African students, and we have already found out the number of students in university E. So the answer is 3%. 3%. 21 is 3% of 684. Moving on to next question. Which university has the highest percentage of students who successfully completed PhD program out of the students who joined university? It's a tricky question, because we want to find the total number of students joined, also the number of students completed that we have already found, and what percentage is that. There is no need to find all the 7 university percentage, because in the option they have given university C, university B, and university F and E. F and E will be finding only those ones. So C, the percentage will be total number of students is in C is 855, and total number of students passed with PhD 741. So 741 by 855 into 100, you get the percentage in C as 86.6%. The next option is B, you have the total passed is 969, and the total students is 1282. So 969 by 1282 into 100 gives you 75.5%. Next option is university F, the total students is 1026 and passed students is 855. So percentage is 855 by 1026 into 100 gives you 75%. Last is E, the total students is 684 and the PhD passed is 513. So percentage of students who passed with PhD 513 by 684 into 100 gives you 83.3. 513 by 684 into 100 gives you 83.3. The question is, which university has highest percentage? From the equations or from the mathematical tabulation, it's clear that University C has 86.6% of the students passed with the PhD. So the answer is option C with 86.6% pass percentage. Okay, so easy one. If you have already found out the number of students who joined the PhD and the number of students who completed the PhD. And the next fourth one, what is the ratio of students who successfully completed PhD program to the students who join in University G? So University G, the number of students joined is 1368, the number of students completed is 684. So ratio is, we'll be writing it in the form of A by B. Here they have asked the ratio is successfully completed to the students who joined G. That means 684 by 1368, you get the ratio as 1/2, that is 1:2 is the correct answer. So the option is B, which gives you the ratio 1:2. Last sub question, the number of students who completed PhD program from University C and D together exceeds the number of students who joined University C and D. So just regular adding and subtracting will give you the marks. So the first they have asked the difference between the who completed PhD from University and D. From University and A and D, the number of students who completed PhD is 1026 and 912, which gives you 1938. Then together the students who join C and D, that is 855 plus 684, that gives you 1539. So the question is, what is the difference? So we'll be subtracting 1539 from 1938, which gives you 399. So you get the answer as 399. Again, easy one, 399. First of all, we added the students who completed PhD from University A and D. We added the students who joined PhD in University C and E. We just find the difference. You get the answer as 399.
Okay, so friends, that's all about data interpretation questions of task number 15. The next task or the next set of data interpretation question paper link is available in the YouTube description. If you want to get it directly, you can join our WhatsApp broadcast. Details given in the description again. And if you are interested in knowing more about Diksha online courses, paper one course, online course, practice series, previous question course, etc., you can visit our website www.dikshaclassroom.com. So that's all about today's Diksha Mission JRF. We'll be seeing you tomorrow, same time. Thank you.